गुड इवनिंग सर, बाटी सर, वेलकम प्रजापन, वेलकम. इट्स माय प्राउड प्रिविलेज टू वेलकम डॉक्टर सुरेंद्रन एंड डॉक्टर रमेश अधिनारी एंड ऑल होल लॉट ऑफ सेलिब्रिटीज टू दिस इवनिंग गैदरिंग. एंड दिस इज द फर्स्ट ऑफ द सीरीज ऑफ बेस्ट फ्रेंड्स फॉर एवर इन लर्निंग जनरल सर्जरी. एंड आई मीन नन अदर देन डॉक्टर सुरेंद्रन रमेश विल बी सूट एज द first participants in this area, because you know they have a lot of respect for each other, and whenever I spoke to them individual basis, they talk about their friend at such nice terms. And actually, you know, since this is the first one, and you know, a pattern has to be set in, the discussion will be on usually they talk to each other. I only interfere once in a while, but they talk about their childhood, what made them take up medicine, their inspiration to take this the medicine, and then their college days, and how did they land in surgical gastroenterology, what prompted them, how were their days in SGE, the good days and the bad days, and their with the study together, and then and subsequent career. One is in government service, on the corporate sector, how they steered their, in spite of whatever restraints, they just forged ahead and you know became celebrities, and then they became office bearers, and they became teachers, and people of national importance. And finally I also asked them to round up on their private lives, how they spent their COVID, and how did they make up for all the lost time with their wives during this COVID period. Over to Dr. Ramesh.
Okay. Yeah, thank you Patta. This is definitely something unique. I don't think that any of us have participated in something like this, and this has been something that is unique. I think I should begin with from the time when did Surendran and I meet, and I can tell you that it was in August end in of 1988 when I came to join MCH. Surendran was in government service, so he had been immediately relieved on being selected. And he had joined about 2 weeks before I did. I had to go and I had to show the letter to, I was working in PhD Institute in Coimbatore at that time as an assistant professor in surgery. Resign, I had some obligations for 2 weeks to vacate my house and all, and then I had to move to Chennai. And then when I came to the first day to work, I still distinctly remember that day etched in my memory, because that first day was a unique day. So that was on a Monday when I joined, and it was, you know, in those days Dr. Rangabhashyam had a unit in surgery and a unit in surgical and the department of surgical gastroenterology, and Monday used to be admission day and our main operating day. So that day, as I joined and I was just standing in one corner, I was asked to go and assist one of our house surgeons for doing a hydro CT. He had already started the case, so I started to, so I went and I assisted him. The bleeding was much more than you would expect in a hydro CT, and we were forbidden from using a diathermy or a cautery on the hydro CT, and we had to just tie some vessels and come out. So at the end of it, I called the senior person assistant there in the department at that time, Alaganandam, and I asked him, should I put a drain? He said, no, we don't ever put a drain, so there's no need for a drain. I said, okay, and we finished the case, shifted the patient. I came the next day for rounds. And morning, 9 o'clock, I came to work. And on the first bed, I saw this patient whose face looked familiar. Normally, the first bed in the ward of 10, number 10 ward, is reserved for sick patients, VIP patients, you know, the first bed next to the nurse's table. I saw this patient's face look familiar. I went, it was the same hydroceal patient we had operated the day before. And there was a unit of blood flowing in a bottle for this patient. And I was informed by the postgraduate, who was one of the PGs, was doing MS, was also, because that was Dr. Rangabhasham had MS PGs also, that this was the fourth bottle of blood that was going for the patient. I said that for a hydrocele to have four bottles of blood, this is completely this thing. And I had noticed that there had been a lot of bleeding on the table. And I remember I have asked the house surgeon who was doing it also whether they have done a bleeding time, clotting time. They had not done. And I asked him, don't you routinely do a bleeding time, clotting time prior to surgery? And he said, no, we don't do. Then Rangabhasham walked in and promptly the first bed he took the rounds. What is this case? Hydrocele. He said, blood is going. And Alaganandam pipes up and says, sir, fourth unit. You know, some of these fellows were experts at lighting a match under Rangabhasham. So Rangabhasham lost his temper. Who assisted and all? Then they said, new MCHPG. Rangabhasham, anybody who comes in from somewhere, you just ask them to assist on a hydrocele. They don't know how to assist on a hydrocele. See so much bleeding and all that. I told Alaganandam on the side, I think we should do a blood test. This is not because of any surgical problem. But he refused. He was scared. If you do a blood test and find something, Rangabhasham will get angry. But I got blasted again 2-3 times on that round. So on my very first day on round, first day surgery, second day round. So what I did was that with the help of Surendran, I took a sample of blood and went and met, there's a man called Sethu Raman, who was the hematologist in Madras Medical College. Acid-tongued individual, acid-tongued, literally. So he said, what happened? We told him the history and gave him the blood. So he put the blood under the slide and then he looked at it and then he looked at two of us up and said, you idiots have operated on ITP again? See, these fellows are not on a platelet count. There are no platelets in the peripheral sphere. He was totally without platelets. Probably must have had 20,000, 30,000, but with all the bleeding, even that has disappeared. Now there is no platelets. So then...
I remember this scenario. You know, what has happened when we entered MCH gastroenterology, the whole ambience was, you know, a little hostile. So the patient's scrotum was covered with a bed sheet. And, you know, when Rangabhasham came on rounds, one of our colleagues just removed the sheet, said this was done by Ramesh yesterday.
Yes.
You know, cricket ball. Immediately, chief said, you take this case and then evacuate the hematoma, bring the patient back. They did the same thing after giving blood transfusion. The next day, it has become a pumpkin size. I remember only then we took the blood to Sethu Raman and then got everything done. That was a real hilarious scenario. All of us were laughing, but chief was shouting at everybody. You, me.
Yeah, everybody. Everybody.
Yeah.
I came to know Surendran and introduced himself that he was, he had been, he done his MS from Stanley, MCH, MBBS from Stanley. And then he was working as an assistant professor at Raipata for 6 years. And he had come to join the MCH course. And you see, what would have happened is that if Surendran finishes, the batch of all the MCH people there at that time who were doing MCH and were done, they all belonged to the same service cadre that included Ratnasamy, Alaganandam, and Sri Kumari, R. P. Shanmugam. They all belonged to that same.
It's called a civil medical list.
No, civil medical list. Yeah. Yeah. And in that medical list, Surendran's rank was number one. So, these people knew that when Surendran clears, he will become senior to all of them. So, the aim was to put Surendran down in front of Dr. Rangabhasham in every way possible. But, I was literally, like what they say in American terms, collateral damage. And on the very first, second day, Surendran took me aside. I said, remember one thing, you just want to get your MCH and you have to get out. 2 years. Don't open your mouth. Whatever they say, don't answer back. Keep quiet. Because I had been trying to do some explanation about the hydrocele and all that. So then he took me aside and said, no, don't answer anything. Just keep quiet. Take it. 2 years, it'll go. Then I also decided to keep shut. And then The first 2 days, 3 days, at lunchtime, there was a small room, if you remember, Patta, next to the ward where everybody used to have lunch.
The stoma room.
No? Stoma room.
Yeah.
So they used to go, because all of them were Madras, they used to bring lunch. They used to, I used to go to the canteen to order some lunch and eat some lunch in the cafeteria. So Surinan asked me, why are you going there? Why are you going out at lunchtime? Where are you going? I said, I go to the cafeteria to eat. He said, no, you come, we'll share lunch. So that day I shared with him his lunch from his tiffin box. And believe it or not, Patta, from the next day, for 2 years, Surendran used to bring two baskets of food, two tiffin carriers, one for himself and one for me. So for 2 years, Mrs. Surendran fed me
Madam is a very good cook, so you enjoyed good
lunch. Yeah, so I was...
When I talk to Ramesh Ardhanari, I still get the smell of freshly brewed coffee. His wife Nirja used to make such a good coffee. I have never tasted coffee, better coffee anywhere else. Isn't it, Ramesh?
Yeah, that typical made from the percolator and everything, you know, that typical coffee, yeah.
Ramesh, going to this subject about you, when I saw you first, I was stunned with, you know, Ramesh used to be in a very widely read and knowledgeable, and he's very vocal, articulate and all those things, you know, and his wits, I suppose his jokes are very, very famous even now. Whenever there is a conference, if Ramesh chairs a session, you see a lot of people at least go and listen to the jokes what he cracks. So these things could not have come just like that overnight. I know that you did all your education in a prestigious institutions, like you did your MBBS in CMC Vellore and your MS in All India Institute. And I'm sure you must have had some good training by your teachers in your school, and your parents also would have helped. You would have got motivated by somebody. Can you tell me something about that? Really, I don't know about that background.
Yeah, I was. My father was an engineer, and he had joined. In those days, everybody used to join the government service or public sector because that was considered safe job, and he had joined and there were not many private jobs in engineering and all in those days. So he had joined the first public sector company that had been started in India was a fertilizer factory in a place called Sindri in Bihar, Dhanbad district of Bihar. Now it is in Jharkhand district. In those days it was in Bihar district. And for the government of India it was a very prestigious factory because it was the first public sector major undertaking that they had taken. So my father was working there. So because of that, I was in that colony. So first is that because you're in a colony, you get a very different upbringing. So if you're in Chennai, if you're in Delhi, if you're in Bombay, then everybody, mostly people around you are all from that local area and you become like, but here in that colony, we had people from Kerala, people from Karnataka, Bengal, Bihar, Maharashtra, every state. And my classmates and my friends were from all languages, all backgrounds. And fortunately, even though it was in a backward district of India, there was the school which was run by Jesuits, the Society of Jesus. And they were good school they had run there in Bihar. They ran about 8 or 9 schools in Bihar and Bengal in those days. And they were all very good academic institutions. So I remember even when I did from school, even up to 5 years before my passing out, the batches which passed out, every year from our school, 3-4 fellows will get into IIT, 2-3 fellows will get into medicine and prestigious other institutions. So it was a very high quality training, and it was all run by American Jesuits. So we had a group of about 10 Americans who used to teach us. So our English, our mathematics, physics were all taught to me by Americans, and they were very good at the teaching, and they taught us the American style, you know, where you were encouraged to read on yourself as far as possible. Teachers were more of a guide. They allowed you to learn a lot of, to do a lot of extracurricular activities. So I used to do that. Of course, the jokes and other things, I think my father was often used to be joking around even in the house, and he used to be known in his circles for telling jokes. And I also picked up that, and I also used to crack jokes. Of course, I got into a lot of trouble in school, and because I used to crack jokes at teachers, at other students and things. So, used to get into some trouble. But by and large, people would laugh and they would move on. And then, of course, getting into Vellore was because I had a couple of seniors who had got into that place. So, I also wrote the entrance exam, and then I made it through the entrance exam, and that's how I went there. It was just that there was somebody who had shown the way, and I followed them.
Ramesh, you know, it is often said that the opposite poles attract each other, no? So my upbringing is exactly opposite. You know, I belong to an agricultural family. My father was the first graduate in the entire district, and he was a mid-level revenue officer. I studied only in a government school, you know, especially first in some panchayat school, then later a board high school like that. And for even a PUC, I couldn't get into a good college. I got an admission only in Pachepas College, which is supposed to be a notorious
notorious college. Yeah, Pachepas always a notorious college. Yeah,
that's true. Notorious college. And you'll be surprised. I was so nervous that at that time, after PUC, I didn't even know the existence of a CMC Vellore, JIPMER, or All India Institute. No, so absolutely no application for all those things. I just thought, okay, I wanted to become a doctor. And I wanted to become a military doctor because I was really interested in NCC and other things. So I applied for MBBS. But anyway, I got into MBBS, and I remember I was so, I don't know to call it as a novice or a less knowledge or whatever it is. The interview committee, those days are all only interview. One Brigadier Kasavalu was the interview chairman. After asking a lot of questions, he asked me, whether anybody in your family is doing medicine. I remember a lot of people outside, they said there's only one MBBS seat per family. My sister was already doing MBBS in Kilpak Medical College. I told them, no, sir. And immediately I said, yes, sir. Then he asked me, what do you say? What do you mean? Is it no or yes? I said, yes, sir. Then why did he say no? I said, my father is sitting outside. And if I tell him that I told you a lie, then he will scold me. That's why. Then he said, okay, you convey my congratulations to your father. So my father asked me, how did you do your interview? I said, okay, I did. What have you got? Do you think that you will get selected? At that, I don't know. But what did the interview people, they said? I told them, they said, convey my congratulations to your father. Then he said, that means you got it. Then I was supposed to go for an interview for a BSc Agri the next day. And I said, then if I got selected, why should I go for a BSc Agri? Then my father said, no, no, having applied, you can never believe the government. Sometimes they may pull you out of the list and something like that. And I went. And finally, you know, they gave us the postings in admission in Stanley Medical College. Stanley, I had a good time. But I always see to that we have good friends. You know, that is very, very, very important for anybody. I should say that if you have good friends, I think half your problem is over. My roommate used to be one of my colleagues. Gauss is a Muslim, other person is Ponnayan, is a Christian, and I'm a Hindu. So they used to call it as an Amar Akbar Antony kind of a group. So that used to be wonderful. And of course, during MBBS, we had a lot of, I would say, encounters and a lot of interesting things. One of our senior, he became a mess representative. And he became very corrupt, rather. So all our mess bills started going up. And once our mess bill started going up, the entire hostel, we revolted, we went in for a strike. All of us went and met the dean, and then this gentleman has to be suspended from the college, or terminated from the college. Least we knew that he's a very close relative of our vice principal and the professor of medicine. And so supporting him, the dean said, how can I suspend without any kind of, you know, proof? Then somebody has to prove that he is corrupt. Then everybody said, yes, sir, we'll do it. He said, no, one of you do it. Somebody push me forward. And it was me who was to prove. Literally 2 months, we didn't go to college. We did all this, we verified all those things. Finally, we proved that gentleman was suspended. And all my classmates said, that's it. So the professor of medicine you have antagonized, you will not pass medicine. And my God, you should know that for 2 years we studied very hard. I thought that at least there are three other examiners who tried to probably just pass us. And then, of course, we got through. Even then, I thought maybe a wrong result. They may call me and then tell you failed this, that, and that. The first day I remember I got my gynae postings. And they said, Dean is calling you. Then I said, finished. So this is the reason the Dean is calling me. Dean was one Dr. M.G. Prabhu. So he called me and then, you are Dr. Surendran. Yes, sir, I am Dr. Surendran. How did you do your exam? He said, sir, I said reasonably well. Reasonably well? No, sir, I did well. Okay, sit. Do you know that you have got 13 gold medals, university medals? I just couldn't believe myself. And finally, then it was true that I was declared as the best outgoing student of our batch, which we least expected. What I am trying to tell again for the our youngsters is, do your duty, work hard. It will be rewarded. Whoever against you, it definitely be rewarded. This I just wanted to tell you. Ramesh, you tell me about your, I should say, about your stay in our Ward 10.
Patta, we had this admission day duty on Mondays. So we were a team. So there will be an assistant, there will be a senior MCHPG, junior MCHPG, then senior and all the MSPGs and households, all of them will be there on duty. So Surendran told me, look, the groups are Alagaanandam, Ratnasami on one side, Pallivelu and Chandramohan on the other side. You won't be able to handle Alagaanandam and Ratnasami. You will get screwed. So you better go and join Pallivelu and Chandramohan. I will tackle these fellows. So that, anybody else would have done it the other way. Having been there before, they would have quietly pushed me into the shark's mouth and they would have quietly escaped with the easy things. It used to be hilarious because I don't know how many of you are this people who have read in those days when we were in school, we used to have one spy versus spy. So there will be a black spy and a white spy. And in one episode, the black spy will win, the next episode, white spy. So it will go on like that. They will be trying to kill each other. So this, like that, these groups will keep trying to get one upper hand on the other. Unfortunately, neither Pallivelu nor Chandramohan were very close to going to tell Rangabhaji Mirithi. Whereas Ratnasami Chandramohan, Ratnasami was a palm fellow even now. He never used to say anything. But Alagaanandam and others would go and give it nicely to NR. And I still remember one day, night we did some interesting case. Palnivelu was operating, I was assisting, we did. End of it, Palnivelu said, shit, we forgot to take photos, man. I said, you just leave it alone. Nobody will remember, we will not tell anything. Like the previous case of the hydroseal, next day, from the front line, other side person gets up and says, sir, this is a very interesting case they did last night, but they didn't take any photographs. What was the finding? What was inside? Nothing was told. Only line was, they didn't take any photographs. Finished. For the next 1 hour, Pallivelu, Chandramohan, Ramesh, he got rammed, three of us. You know, every bed will get stand and we'll get rammed. And it went on for about, 2 days, 3 days. We were thrown out of the rounds. Then we all had to go to his room and apologize before we were allowed back into rounds. I don't know whether you remember that episode, Surendra.
Yeah, I remember very well. Yeah, chief used to shout at, even G.V. Rao was there, no?
G.V. was also there.
Because G.V., He didn't probably do some favor to chief for something, and he was literally screwed. Same thing with Pallivelu also.
Yeah, Pallivaru was a perpetual bakra, you know, like for every Eid, one or two camels and goats, then they'll be cut. Pallivaru will be getting beheaded every day by chief.
During the emergency period, you know, 1975, I had an opportunity to go and join AIMS. I was there for 6 months. My God, I didn't know language. My food habit was pretty bad. You know, I couldn't live with that Madrasi mess, you know, the only phulgobi and chapati. In my Stanley, I had seen how surgeons were doing GJs in those days. We got him with GJs. But after going to AIMS, we were asked to assist for piles and other things. I remember Vajpayee, our former prime minister, was an MP. He underwent hemorrhoidectomy. I used to be the third assistant, the chief, and Atham Prakash only operator. So that really got bugged. I wrote to Rajshekhar Reddy. He was my boss in Stanley. And he told me, no, it's not a suitable place. You come back. So after that, I resigned. I came back to Stanley and joined MS. And in fact, they asked me, where do you want to go to Stanley? You can have MS in MMC. I said, no, sir, Stanley is my alma mater. There I know everybody and it used to be good. And that was a fantastic period, I should say. In fact, those days, Rajshekhar Reddy was the only person who was operating on pancreas in 75. Nobody used to touch. They used to say, pancreas, don't touch pancreas. The patient will die of pancreatitis. They say, even a biopsy, you cannot take those days. And
fortunately, by the time I joined, I joined in July. And in the February, Atham Prakash had died. He had a sudden massive MI and he died. And when I joined, all the other PGs, they told us, you know, the night Atham Prakash died, we had a big party. Everybody became... the next chiefs who came, Ashton who came, they were very generous in giving cutting to all the PGs, senior registrars. And before that, Atham Prakash's unit, only he will operate. Nobody else will operate. He was like he was not like a typical AIMS professor. He was AIMS professors after that would be all, you know, they'll give BML Kapoor, IK, they'll all give everybody a chance. He was typical, that old style professor. Only he will operate, everybody has to observe, and he will give big lectures. And
that's the reason I came back. And after MS, you know, you mentioned about our the civil medical list, the service commission. We all decided to go abroad after MS. But a couple of us thought, why not we appear for the service commission? It is a 1980 service commission. And if you get selected, if you get a good rank, maybe we'll stay back. And if you get a good posting, we'll stay back. Otherwise, we'll go abroad. With that idea only, we went. You know, those days for a service commission, everybody will go for an interview with a white pant, white shirt. And, the haircut and all those things. But in 75, we all used to have a huge, the hair, a kind of. So our batch, we thought we should never have a haircut. We should not wear a white and white. We should go with the colored tee. And then we also should wear a tie. And we wanted to revolt. And in that interview, service commission, you know, the chairman was good. But there's one lady, I forgot her name, or doctor. She asked me about the Philadelphia chromosome. We were appearing for the exam in about a couple of months' time. And she said, it's a 21st chromosome. I said, madam, you are wrong, it's a 22nd. She was upset. Then she started arguing, no, madam, look, we are appearing for the exam in another 2 months. So we have just read, we are fresh, so I'm correct, maybe you can refer. Those days, no the internet and no Google and all those things. And the chairman said, he's correct. He has got so many gold medals. And she was a little upset. He asked me, okay, doctor, if you select for MBBS, will you join a PSC? I said, no, sir. Why? I said, sir, I'm doing a surgery. So if you give me a posting in a PSC where a surgery can be done, I'll go and join. Otherwise, I will not. So you won't, is it? But this is basically meant for MBBS. I said, no, sir, I'm MBBS, but I'm doing MS. Then that's all. I thought I won't get selected. And it is a surprise that because of that, he gave me a good marks. Maybe my rank was number one out of 1,800 candidates. So I didn't know that. I never imagined that would be a negative point when I did my MCH.
Yeah, but that became the main reason that you have became the target everybody.
I remember, but you did well, and you were always an. You got through the first attempt, but I failed.
I know.
If you can tell the reason behind such an excellent student failing, now that there's
I will tell you the fact was that they were anticipating that within 6 months of our exams, within the next 6 months, they will have promotions, and that Shanmugam, Sri Kumari, and all of these people will get promoted because they were the only ones with qualifications, and there are four posts of reader, professor level coming up in Madras Medical College, Stanley Medical College, in Rayapeta Hospital, and in Madurai. So they thought that these four people will get into the chief position, and then once they get into chief, they become senior automatically for the rest of the time. So that was the idea behind. So because it was within 6 months, if Surendra had been failed, then he was not able to appear in that exam because he didn't have a degree. He was technically a failed candidate. So he wouldn't have been able to appear. But what happened was that, you know that when you have bad intentions and you try to do, and I know that this happened for all his contributions, because without Rangabhashyam and MCH degree, me, you, Surendran, Palaniveru, all of us would have been just another general surgeon. It was his great contribution to surgery to start a specialty. But he was easily swayed by people whom he had in his circle. And they swayed him that Surendran will come, he will come up, and he is not in our circle. And you know, they sort of fed him this information. And I know that this happened because a couple of years after the exam, I was talking to both BML Kapoor and Prakash Khanduri outside later. You see, I knew these people before anybody else did in this department. And the first time that I was recognized by Rangabhashyam was when Palaniveru and Aranganandam were writing their second attempt exam in GH. So we were standing in the ward saying that today the examiners are coming. And when in walked Khanduri, he had come by car from Vellore as an examiner. He had come by car because Vellore is next door. He saw me standing here. He said, Ramesh, you come here. What are you doing here? And then he took me inside, introduced me to Rangabhashyam, talked with me for 10 minutes, and then sent me out. And then after another 20 minutes, I think some Ratnaswami Chandramohan had gone to receive BML Kapoor in the airport. They brought him. And they took him in. As they were taking him, he saw me. Hey, Ramesh, what are you doing here in Hindi? He said, come. And he took me in, and again he introduced me to Rangabhashyam, and he said, this is my student, he's a very good, all sorts of things. And I actually, only from that day, I was looked upon as a human being. Till then, my status was like a dog on the wardrobes. You know, after that, he used to ask me some questions and some things. But coming back to Surendran, and so they didn't want him to pass that exam. So the first idea given was that you fail both, because then it won't look like there was any imbalance. But unfortunately for them, of the four examiners, I had three internal examiners. I had Rangabhashyam, and then I had both BML Kapoor and Prakash Khanduri, who were my past to the extent that our fourth examiner was S.P. Kaushik from SDPGI. And when I came to the ward rounds, Kaushik told me, I believe that I am your only external examiner. All of these people have taught you over the years. I nodded, yes, sir. He said, then only I will be asking questions. They are not interested in talking to you. He said like this to me, and he was asking me for the whole time. But I did reasonably well, and when we look back and what I heard about the discussion of Surendran, no, he also did reasonably well. There was nothing major that he did that would be considered. See, in medicine, you can always disagree with the line of management, with the line of treatment, if you want to, isn't it? So things are made big of. So there was a CS stomach, which was obviously metastatic. So there was a discussion, and I think he said we can give palliative chemotherapy if nothing. And they Rangabhasham jumped on him. What palliative chemotherapy? What good it will do? And then, you know, sort of took it, and that was used as a reason to fail him. Sri Kumari and R.P. Shanmugam could pass. I'm telling you that before joining his MCH, Subhendra knew more than them after they had finished their MCH. So,
this apart, Ramesh, you had three internal examiner, one external examiner. But
you had four examiners.
He asked me, why is that? How is that you are having four external examiners? This is what
examiners, exactly. Exactly. That is how it was like for you.
Anyway, I thought, okay, it's all part of the game. You can fail or pass in the exam. But I was very upset that it was the first failure. But later on, when the university was advised not to conduct the supplementary exam after 6 months for a surgical gastroenterology because there is only one candidate, I was really upset. I went and met the controller of examinations. I told her, madam, if there is no supplementary exam for any of the specialties, I'll keep quiet. Only surgical gastroenterology, there is no exam, I'm going to the court. And there is a lot of this thing, then there is a supplementary exam in that probably I was, they were made to give me a pass. And after that, this last 6 months has not changed anything for that matter. Maybe we are worried.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Yeah, what happened was that they never got the promotion because four general surgeons who were waiting for promotion and senior people, they filed a case in court saying that if general surgeons can become assistant professors of gastroenterology like Rangabhasham, we can also become and we should be given those posts. That they were senior assistant professors. So they had gone to court. So actually the government decided that for 2 years they will not give anybody any promotion because those fellows will retire and after that we can take care of this. And they actually waited for those four fellows to retire. Before the court case was settled. And so, Surendran actually after that he became senior and he got the Stanley posting and he became chief at Stanley where he stayed.
If I can interrupt here, my friend Vidya Mohanram is also on the thing, sir. She wants to ask something. But before that, I just want you to know that you come from very good academic institutions and Surendran has been an excellent student. How were you doing academics during that time? There were no any established protocol of classes, clinics, and
I'll take this question. You know, the though as Ramesh said, Rangabhasham sir, but for Rangabhasham there is no MCH and there is no surgical gastroenterology, especially in the South India. But unfortunately, there is no structured program, and there is no teaching. And all that we have learned is, one, we have learned it during our sabbatical in CMC and AIMS. And whatever we learned before MCH, that was helpful. And most of our technique, MCH. Maybe, you know, I was working in Stanley Medical College where R.P. Shanmugam is a very good surgeon. So we used to see him operating and we used to go to places and get the surgery seen and all. But Ramesh, he joined Meenakshi Mission Hospital, where I think he's an egg-alive, and he learnt it by himself, by trial and error. But what I like in Ramesh, in one thing is the institutional loyalty. You know, he joined Meenakshi Mission Hospital soon after his MCH. 30 years, he never moved outside, in spite of, you know, people started asking him, come and join, we'll do that, we'll do this. I suppose my colleagues, especially the liver transplant colleagues, should learn this. Whenever a true liver transplant surgeon meets, they'll say, okay, this group, they have gone joined this hospital. This group has left this hospital. This is going to be the talk. But I really like Ramesh, where he stuck to the hospital, saw that the hospital is developed, and now it is recognized as one of the best hospital, one of the best teaching center for a surgical gastroenterology. Isn't it, Ramesh?
Many times I got calls from Bombay, Delhi, from many of these big hospitals, and they, especially in the 90s, after I had started doing a lot of minimal access surgery and I was recognized for my work in laparoscopy and I was doing a lot of procedures way back people used to call me to come and head departments of minimal access surgery, start minimal access surgery in many places. But, you know, I don't know. A lot of people only think of money as the most important thing. I looked at it from two points. One is money. You must have enough to be happy. That is right. But other thing is that one is respect, and the other thing is that if you can build a department, if you can get some academic, I was all keen on doing some academic activities because of, you know, family financial position, I wasn't in a position to work in a government hospital. You know, I had no political connections, and then running for the service, they will keep transferring you, especially if they think that you are easy to handle. And I didn't have any connections to go keep running up.
How did you land in Madurai, and how did you land in Meenakshi?
It is because of Surendran. I landed in Madurai and Meenakshi because of Surendran. In 1988, we had gone to ASCON. That was the Silver Jubilee Conference, or the Golden Jubilee Conference, that was held in Delhi in 88 December. And when we went there, Surendran's close friend from Theni, which is about 80 kilometers from here, from Madurai, Ram Kumar was his name. He is now no more. He's passed away. He and Surendran were MS batchmates. And Surendran introduced me to Ram Kumar, and Ram Kumar was asking me, what are you planning on doing? I said, see, I don't know. I am a private candidate. I'm not a government sponsored candidate. I have to look for a job because I can't start my own practice and things like that. So then he said, I will introduce you to this friend of mine, Dr. Sethuraman, who is building a big private hospital in Madurai. Why don't you talk to him? And he has plans of putting gastroenterology in a major way in the institution. Why don't you talk to him? And if you like it, you can join. So he introduced me during ASCON to Dr. Sethuraman. The first meeting was hilarious. You know, this gentleman comes. He is wearing this the safari suit, you know, that we used to call safari suit, white and white. On top of that, he's wearing a coat. And he's wearing only chappals. But when I started talking to him, he had this intensity. And like Surendran, he is a multiple gold medalist in Madurai Kamaraj University, about 17 gold medals, best student in MS and MCH, everything. And a very big practice. And he said that he's building a hospital. And believe me, he talked to me for almost an hour. And he told me about this hospital he had a dream of in 1988. He said there will be a big 750-800-bedded hospital which will have an auditorium where we want to do postgraduate courses. We want to start, have national conferences. I thought that he was just, you know, talking through his hat. Frankly, I had that feeling because nice to listen to, but it didn't seem plausible. Because at that time, he had not even put a single brick on the ground. And he took my name and my address and everything and put it into a small piece of paper that he tore from the corner of the souvenir, and he put it in his purse. And then I forgot about it and I never remembered. Till 89 December, 1 year later, I got a letter from Meenakshi Mission Hospital title from Dr. Sethuraman asking me to come for an interview to Madurai on such and such date. So then I went to Madurai. I knew nobody in Madurai, but luckily, 1 year junior to us, the next batch, the two PGs, Subramaniam and Muthukrishnan. Muthukrishnan was a native of Madurai, and his family owned a lodge in the main part of the city, and he made arrangements for me to stay. And then I went from there and attended the interview. And at that time, the hospital had not started working in December. And it actually started working only in April of 1990. And when I joined in April of 1990, I joined on the first day the hospital began. And I did have an idea that I wanted to settle in a second-tier city, not in a primary city, because in a primary city, already you have many big jambavans, you know, people like Rangabhashyam, Vittal, you know, you can't compete with them. They are giants. So I thought, move to a second-tier city, and with a degree, maybe I can get somewhere going and then do something. And literally, I learned everything after I came to Meenakshi Mission, what I use today. Endoscopy, he had bought the entire set of endoscopes. So I had everything and I just started putting upper GI scope, colonoscope, ERCP scope. I started doing ERCPs on my own. I learned all of it from books and I started doing it. And then laparoscopy, we got some demo instruments, and then we bought a set, and I started to do lab. I didn't go anywhere for training. I started on my own. So it, the best part of it was that I had a chairman who would allow me to do this in a private practice.
I remember, Ramesh, you took the side viewing scope, you went to AIG. No? At that time, they were operating in Medinova, Rao and Nagi, for a training in side viewing endoscopy and ERCPs. That's why, you know, you need to have a person, like in RPS also, he allowed us to do all surgeries. He never stopped us, you know, because he never had any kind of a thing. He's a very good chief, I should say. Like in Kilpak Medical College, I was working under Professor A.B. Selvarangam. If he does a case, next Ahmed Ali has to do a major case. Next, I have to do a major case. Like that, it will go on rotation. In 94, you remember, I came to Madurai. You know, we were promoted. In fact, R.P. Shanmugam, Sri Kumari, Subramaniam and myself were promoted on the same day with the same GO. And though, according to my seniority, I should have occupied a post in Chennai, but they asked me to go to Madurai. I thought, okay, Madurai, I heard, but I never been to Madurai Medical College before. But I had a good understanding, like, you know, this will be a very good college. After joining only, I knew that people were not interested in developing this department. I had a tough time.
I remember.
In 6 months time, as a reader in surgical gastroenterology, I have not seen a single patient. I have not done a single surgery. Every week I used to meet the secretary, ask him, please give me some work. And finally, after 6 months, he himself got dejected. He was irritated. He asked me, suppose if I post you in Tirunelveli, he's from Tirunelveli, will you go there? I said, yes, sir, I'll go there, but please give me some work there in Tirunelveli. Only then he asked me to sit. He said, no, doctors would always like to come to Chennai. How is that you want to go to Tirunelveli? I said, sir, I went up to Madurai, I've never been. Tirunelveli is just close to Madurai than to Chennai. Then he said, he asked me, which is your native place? I said, Dharmapuri district, which is the medical college close, Salem Medical College. You know what happened? Overnight, he shifted the entire department to Salem Medical College. And then he wanted to post me there. And at that time, Dr. Subramaniam was working in Peripheral Hospital, Annanagar. His native was Salem. He wanted to go to Salem. So he went to Salem and I came and joined Peripheral Hospital, Annanagar. People started talking. Dr. Surendran has given 30 lakhs to minister and got the entire department transferred to Salem and he got the Chennai postings. And some used to say that Subramaniam was so influential and related to Minister Muthuswamy, and he had the department transferred and got the postings. Actually, we didn't pay a single pie to anybody. So this is the story of how Salem Medical College got a surgical gastroenterology without even major medical college like a Coimbatore or a Tanjavur or Madurai. They didn't get a SG department. Only now they got it.
Yeah, before you, Palniveru had the same experience in Madurai. He was posted to Madurai.
But the problem, Palniveru was posted as an assistant professor of surgery. Working in a surgical department. But I was posted as the chief of surgical gastroenterology. At that time, I was only 39 years old. So they were like me there. But now they have become good friends, all right. But we did have a lot of problem. And after that, after joining Peripheral Hospital, because 6 months I was starving without doing a single surgery. And in Peripheral Hospital, except a transplant, we started doing all surgery. I remember, Radha, you came once to Peripheral Hospital for watching a shunt, isn't it?
Yeah, I did.
So Peripheral Hospital, people ask me, how come you are doing? Because it is something like a talk hospital only. One Dr. Ashokan is a good friend of mine. He was my colleague there in the Peripheral Hospital. His house was in the next campus. So literally, he is supposed to be on duty every day. So with that, with the confidence, you know, we used to do all major surgeries. And then in 1 year time, I got a transfer to Stanley Medical College. And at that time, people were worried. I used to tell them, no, I don't want to go to MMC. I will stick around in Stanley, but nobody believed. Only when the counseling came, when Sri Kumari went, I did not appear for the counseling. And people knew that I meant it. In fact, once a director of medical education told in an open meeting that Dr. Surendran put MMC into shame because he didn't want to come and occupy the MMC. He wanted to stick on to Stanley, you know, with the valid reason. You know, I remember when I first joined Stanley, Kannan, Balachander and Darwin were associate, my colleagues there. So I've told them, look, I have got a long innings. I had around 15 years to go as a chief of a unit. Nobody will have this opportunity. So my ultimate aim is to organize a liver transplant program. Everybody laughed. And sir, what is this? We can't do even a major surgery and you are planning for a liver transplant. I said, you try, you aim high. Maybe we may reach, we may not reach, all right. Then we said, I want people to specialize in individual organs. Like one of you have to take pancreas, other one has to take liver, other one has to take esophagus and stomach, one for colorectal, like that we separated. I think Balachandra was doing a good colorectal and lap work. And Kannan wanted to take up pancreas. And because we used to get a lot of pancreas, but we used to get only very few operable liver tumor. So Jaswant was taking a liver as his specialty, and I used to assist him like that. And we knew that we cannot do major surgery because in Stanley at that time, no good ICU, nothing. And very, very poor. So we thought, you know, we should start something. And there is the fourth floor of MMC and the Stanley was kept vacant, you know, the surgical block for 15 years for some reasons. One day I brought in a secretary and then I showed it to him. I said, I want to have this that particular floor. He asked me, what do you want to do? I said, sir, we want to do some major surgery. So we want to do a good carrier, something like a semi-ICU. Then he said he will do it. My God, to get that ICU, we had to struggle for 4 years. And finally, we got it. And we also introduced a kind of, you know, the PPE, the public-private partnership. We thought we got a government permission to charge a reasonable amount, around 5,000 rupees per admission, so that we can employ private nurses. Still, that is continuing there. You know, the ILBS, once I visited Delhi, people said that is the first GI Bleed Center started in 2005. No, it is wrong. In Stanley, we have started it in 1999. And the year 2000, we got an ISO certification, the first hospital, government hospital in the country to have an ISO certification, so that we can have everything in. I knew that my tenure there is not permanent, so anytime they can transfer me. So we thought an ISO should be there to continue our work. And then slowly we improve the department. We got, you know.
Sir, if I can just ask a question here.
Yeah.
You worked there like you worked in a central institution, that your timings are not 8 to 1 or 9
absolutely.
To 1. You
worked no, absolutely.
How did your assistants agree to it?
You know, the problem is I have my strong view. If you work 10 to 1, you can never do any major surgery. So in the GI Bleed Center, I was telling you, know, the 5,000 rupees we used to collect and then pay the staff nurses. And we had a lot of problem with that also for the housekeeping. But in that, we had around 80 lakhs surplus money with the Medical Services Corporation. And in fact, the MD asked me whether they can send that money back, give that money back to the government. I said, no, sir, to get the money from the government is difficult. We want so many equipments. Like at that time, we had a lot of equipment which is not available even in the big corporate hospital. So a lot of people, they used to come and ask me, sir, I would like to come and work here because they want to have a hands-on training. I told them most welcome, but there are certain rules and regulations. You need to stay till about 5:30. I'll also stay, no problem. And you need to do some good academic work. You need to work hard. If you want to be an extraordinary department, you have to work little extra. That's what. People who are willing only came and joined. Otherwise, I told them you can leave anytime. There is no harm. A lot of people are waiting. That is how, you know, I will really appreciate Dr. T.J. Balachandra. He's senior to me, in fact. But still, he worked as an assistant professor. He was doing duty and amazing. You know, in the age of 52, he got his fellowship, FRCS.
Yeah,
huh?
Amazing, yes.
Yeah,
Pata, I don't know whether you know this or not. But for quite a few years, Surendran was a member of the institute, All India Institute body. He was on the expert committee. Then he was chairman of the selection committee of All India Institute. The selection committee that selected the director at that time of All India Institute, he chaired the selection committee. And then he was also chairman of the selection committee of JIPMER for about 5 years. And so, Surendran, you have been seeing the north part, you know, the politics of All India Institute and everything. And also you've seen the politics in the south, having been in the government service and on the selection bodies and all these things. What do you think of this north-south divide? What is your own personal...
You know, except for the fact that, you know, I have heard once a High Court judge commented in Delhi, in All India Institute, how do you manage the patients because all the chiefs are here? That's what he is supposed to have commented. But my own experience is, you know, they were all very good. I remember I went to that ICMR one day for our stem cell project in Stanley. The All India Institute and ICMR are more or less the same campus. So I walked into the director's room. Dogra, the forensic professor, was the director. At that time, there were about 100 people gathering him. I went and asked them, why is it? Then they said, you know, our Chatterjee, our gastroenterologist, Chatterjee was supposed to retire that particular day. His age was 62 at that time. But in an institute body, we have already decided that the retirement age should be probably 65 years. And 3-4 months back. But only thing is that order was not passed to the institute. So these people were asking, he is 62, he is retiring today. If the order had come, he will continue for another 3 more years. What is surprising was, the people who are standing in the forefront were S.K. Acharya and our Piyushani. If Chatterjee retires, Piyushani will be the head of the department. But he was fighting for a Chatterjee to continue. It's an amazing thing. Then at that time, I remember Hota was the central health secretary. I rang up and asked him, why haven't you conveyed this to the institute? And he said, sir, the minister has not signed. Fortunately, I had the minister's cell phone number. I rang up. At that time, he was in Geneva. He asked me, why are you interested in this particular gentleman? I told him, sir, Chatterjee is it's a very good teacher, I should say. He will not suppress anybody. He will try to bring in more. He is academician. He is not after money because he has been continuing here. And if he goes out, it is a loss to the institute. He said, then in that case, ask Hota to send the file to me by fax. I will sign it. Send it to fax. Believe me, in 45 minutes, the order came to institute. And Chatterjee continued for 3 years. And this, I think, S.K. Acharya mentioned in a meeting about 3 months back. I met him somewhere, not 3 months, I think it's in December. So he mentioned it. You remember that? I said, yes, sir, he deserved it, isn't it? Yeah, very well, he deserves. So, but similarly, when there is a director post vacant in All India Institute, from Prime Minister's office, they have sent two people to bring in somebody. And they were suggesting various names, including our good friend Sarin's name. But at that time, the ILBS has not come. Halfway through it was. In fact, I went and visited the ILBS. Beautifully it was coming. And our Dr. Sarin was a good friend of Sheila Dikshit at that time, the CM of Delhi. She has given him, I think, 350 crores or so on some 3 acres of land in Vasant Kunch. And the plan was very good. And it was definitely a brainchild. So I told them, how can you take Sarin as a director of All India Institute? What will ILBS do? Strongly, I opposed. He said, can we talk to Sarin? Yes, I think you can. I'm sure he also will refuse. And finally, they have agreed. They have selected that Deka, the ENT surgeon, was selected at that time as a director. And Sarin, he put his all effort. You see, what is the standard of an ILBS now? They are competing with the corporate center there. But it is a government hospital, a state government hospital. And after his retirement, he was given two, three times extension and the people did not object. But what I saw here in South India is entirely different. You know, first, when I asked for a budget for a liver transplant, it's Madam Jayalalitha who sanctioned this 5 crore for a liver transplant program. Unfortunately, in about 6 months' time, the government changed. The DMK government came, one health minister said, no transplant, nothing, you go and ask your, when your government comes, maybe you can proceed. I said, sir, this is also our government. No, they thought that, at that time, the health minister was Mr. Dalavai Sundaram. He was a good friend of us, he used to visit Stanley. They thought I am an ADMK man. So, and then we had to meet the then chief minister, Karunanidhi, then I explained the whole thing. Then I said, doctors, they don't come into politics. Then because of his insistence that, you know, it developed. Unfortunately, at that time I mentioned about this ILBS and 350 crores of thing. The CM told me, you identify a place, I will give you the place. I will give you 450 crores, you do a good job. That's exactly what he said. You know, opposite to Stanley, there was a huge PW, it's a kind of a workshop come go down. It, I think from Second World War it was there. It's about 8 acres of land. Then I told CM sir, that is the land available, but for that Stanley cannot expand. You know, when they gave that 10 acres of land, the old jail next to GH, MMC, the same GO, they had given this 8 acres of land to Stanley. He asked his private secretary, one Mr. Munir Hoda, he is retired now, but he's still in Chennai. Ask him, please tell Dr. Surendran that we had given him land. We'll organize a meeting where I'll give him 450 crores. Unfortunately, again, in 3 to 4 months time, the government changed. The 350 crore, 400 crores has gone. And the 8 acres of land they have allotted, they have built some hostel, they have built all those things. My plan was to build a beautiful hospital like an ILBS and a big research center. I thought the stem cells should be transferred there and it will be a hub for, you know, the kind of a Southeast Asia, you know, for a Ceylon, Sri Lanka, and all those people should come for a liver ailment to Chennai. That was my idea, but that didn't fructify. That got probably gone with the bin. And again, what happened, I had seen people. The analogy is this. Chatterjee was extended for 3 years, and that is good. But, you know, Stanley, when I asked my colleagues to get trained in a liver transplant, nobody wanted to. People said, sir, we have got practice. We cannot spend time. Only Dr. Jaswant was willing to do it. So I sent him for a training in various places. And his probably time had come for him to get a promotion. He was promoted and posted in Salem. Then I told the minister, how can you run? At least we need two people to do, one for a donor, another one for a recipient. We cannot do. We will suspend this program. Then they got Jaswant on a deputation to Stanley Medical College. People started becoming bad, like they become violent. They actually, the associations of surgeons, you know, the surgeons association, they went on for a strike. They carried banners. They said, Dr. Surendran, down, down, and all those things. When we were doing a transplant, this is what is happening. And I was told that it is instigated by our own friends. There is a small tidbit, I should tell you that Naganath Babu was one of the person who was standing with a banner there during that, you know, the when they raised the voice. After that was over, I rang up Naganath Babu. Naganath Babu, how are you? But you have come all along to Stanley, but you have not come to my room. Why don't you come and have a cup of coffee? Then Naganath Babu said, no, sir, I'm sorry, sir. I was pressured, sir. I won't be able to, no, I won't do this, sir. All those things. I said, Naganath Babu, I am not asking you anything. Please come and come to my room and have a cup of coffee and go. He did come. So that was the kind of, you know, we were good to people and the people are really good to me. Unfortunately, in South, there is less and less of a statesmanship. They don't see the ultimate goal. Who is going to get benefited? If I do a liver transplant program, if I start in Stanley, or if I start a program in stem cell work in Stanley, am I going to be benefited? No. I'm not going to be benefited. It's a public who is going to be benefited. But somehow they had a lopsided view that they thought that I will be benefited. So they were dead against it. So that is what happened. I suppose you understand, Radha.
Radha, I still remember in 2000, there was a Tamil Nadu ASI meeting in Salem. It was conducted in Aircard. Surendran was a faculty member in the CME. I was speaking. Chandramohan was speaking. Professor Ena was also one of the speakers, and he was being honored and all that. So I was sitting during the meeting with Mrs. Ena, you know, and she was sitting next to me. And she looked at me and said, I'm going to ask you a question. Can you answer me? I said, what she's going to ask? I said, yes, madam, whatever you think. She says, I am also seeing for last 10 years, all these meetings, I come whenever chief is speaking, I see the same people giving lectures. Surendran, yourself, H. Ramesh, Chandramohan. And I don't see the others. Why they are not called? So very embarrassing it became. I said, madam, because maybe they were busy, they refused. We were able to be, we like to do some academic work, so we accepted and so we came. And she said, no, I don't think that is the reason. She didn't pursue, but she herself said, no, I don't think that is the reason. So this was also being noticed by a lot of people that from the earlier batches, 4 or 5 of us were able to get into the faculty and give lectures and all within a shorter period of time than many other people. And one of the main reasons was that we had an MCH degree, which many people didn't have. And that gave us the opportunity to progress faster. So to Dr. Rangabhashyam, for all his, whatever, we all owe a great debt of gratitude for having thought of the idea of starting an MCH gastroenterology. And I still remember when I came to Madras, to Madurai here, many of the general surgeons would say, what gastroenterology? We also do this, you also do this, I would, and all that. Then later, others would come in private and say, sir, avare 4 apply pannaru for this seat, he didn't get. He has been trying to get admission in MCH gastro, he has not got. That is why he's talking like this to you. They say, about 3-4 people, they talk like this.
The lighter vein, Ramesh, I remember one of the meetings, somebody asked Ramesh that what is the difference between a Ramesh before MCH and after MCH. Ramesh has told them that Dr. Ramesh after MCH has developed a big biceps, by retracting the retractor he developed. I remember, you remember that joke, really?
Yeah.
And he said, I want to ask a favor from a god. At least from next birth, I should be born with a tail so that, I can wind the train around the light and then see what is happening in the operation table. That's the kind of a joke he used to...
During my MS days, when I was doing MS, the books I used to buy, I used to write my name, Dr. Ramesh Adhanari, MBBS, CRS. So a lot of people used to ask me, what is the CRS? I said, I am the chief retracting surgeon. So I used to call myself CRS, chief retracting surgeon.
About why others are not being represented in various other meetings and all, I should say that almost all my colleagues in Stanley, they are all very good surgeons. They are all very good academicians. But somehow, their popularity is not known outside. And in fact, for some of them, I have arranged for a training in a pancreatic transplant with the world's best center, Minnesota. The Raja Kansami was our student in Kilpak Medical College. In fact, he came to Stanley. Then I introduced my colleagues to them. I told them, no, please take them for at least 3 months training. And he was willing. But unfortunately, these people, they did not go because of practice. So they will lose 3 months practice. And I see what happens now. That's what I keep telling. Practice we need, money we need, but there is something else beyond that. The kind of a professional satisfaction. That I think you should, it should go to the youngsters. Ramesh, can I ask you something? I'm sure when you did your MCH or your MS or MBBS, you must have had some kind of a goal. This is what I want to achieve. Do you think you have achieved? And if so, how, and if not, why?
I still remember that even when I was studying in 5th class, 6th class in school, my aim was to be a doctor and it was to be a surgeon. And I was fascinated by Christian Barnard. When I was in 1967, when he did his first heart transplant, I was a 9-year-old studying in 3rd class or second class or something like that. But in the next few years, I would read magazines about Christian Barnard, about the heart transplant, and fascinated by the way of Christian Barnard, his lifestyle, everything. So I was, even before beginning my MBBS, I had decided that I would be a surgeon. I had not decided I would be a cardiothoracic surgeon or this thing. That I had not made my mind. In that, when I attended my interview in Bellore and my classmate who got in with me, Rajshekhar Vedantam, who is now an emeritus professor of neurosurgery at CMC Bellore, he was very clear even at the time of joining MBBS. He told in the interview he wants to be a neurosurgeon. So his idea was from school to be a neurosurgeon. He had thought of that idea. And he, as soon as he finished MBBS, that's the only, he never applied for anything else. He applied for straight for a 5-year course which had started in those days, and he joined in Vellore and continued. I wanted to be a surgeon, and in Vellore there are only 6 seats, and unfortunately 5 of those 6 seats in my year were given to sponsored candidates. Only one was given to a non-sponsored candidate, and that was to my classmate who was the best outgoing student of Madras University. So I think any college will give the best outgoing student of the university, not just the college, to though in the entrance exam I had scored more than him, they still gave him the seat, which is natural. So I didn't feel bad about it. So I then went and wrote various interviews, exams, and I got into All India Institute, where I joined. And after doing general surgery, I did 3 years of senior residency, and I thought, yes, this is my training is complete, and I would like to now settle down somewhere. And my idea was to start a practice, join a hospital, and get things. And with that idea, I came to Coimbatore, to PSG, where I became an assistant professor. I used to teach, and I was trying to start a practice. But I found myself struggling to get into the practice circles. And then I learned that in practice circles, there are many circles. One is the religious circle, then is the classmate circle and the college circle. And then there is the caste circle. So all these are very important. Unfortunately for me, I didn't belong to a dominant caste. I studied in Vellore, so I didn't have classmates in places like Coimbatore, Salem, Chennai, etc. Not many who would be able to refer me cases. And religion also, our religion, the inter-religion reference is not like in other religions. So with this, then I decided that I needed something more than an MS. And I decided to do an FRCS or do an MCA. To do an FRCS, I had to go abroad to write the exam. I needed some money, so I was trying to save for that. Meantime, I wrote the entrance exam and I managed to get the seat. So, actually, I remember when I asked the advice from many people, most people said, don't do the MCH, it is useless. Only my aunt, who was a doctor, she said, no, go and do it, it will be useful. And I don't regret doing it. And when I did it, my ambition was to have a good surgical practice, to do a lot of cases, train a lot of people, have a good team, and to build a department which can be a teaching department. I can't do like in a medical college, but the national board or something I can bring up. This was my idea when I started and joined this place. And I think most of it I have achieved in life.
That's true, Ramesh. I think it is an amazing phenomenon. Rather, you know, it's an institute of choice by the national board students. You know, when they get a good ranking, they would like to join you because the way you develop your institute is something great. If you take me, what happens, you know, when I was 6 or 7 years old, my father was admitted in a general hospital in a cardiac unit. Professor Sadasivam, on his name only, the entire Sadasivam building is there. He was the chief. When I went to visit my father along with my mother, and he came on rounds and we were all shunted out. You see, chief is coming, get out. Everybody was shunted out. And as a small boy, I just went under his cot and I sat there. And I saw after his rounds, I asked my father, why is it people are so scared about this gentleman? And my father said, it is not scare person, and it is the respect they want to give. And you also should become a doctor like him in future. That's exactly what my father said. After I joined service, he said, the doctor, the guard doesn't give this chair to everybody. People wanted to come to a service, but he's not getting. People want to become a DME, dean. No, not everybody is getting it. So if you get a chair, that means God is expecting you to do something. If you don't fulfill that, I won't call it as a crime. It is a sin. And he used to say that the crime will end with you, but the sin will come for generations and generations. That is one of the reasons why I stayed back in Stanley till my retirement. I thought I should give my best in spite of, you know, luring. I remember a lot of people in a major corporate hospital, they offered me huge money. I mean, I won't say that. It is unbelievable and I cannot even imagine that money. But luckily, by God's grace, I did not listen to them. I continued and I think I was
sir,
probably...
If I can ask Surendran sir a question.
Yeah.
All the IAS people want to see you for whatever reason, even with Piles or Fisher or whatever. You made a name in the corporate sector also while working so late in the government sector. And, very few could make a big name in the corporate sector once they left the government sector. How was that you could balance all these? Did you have a vision that after government service, I need to have a good corporate sector?
No, it is not that way. You know, General Ramdas, our surgical gastroenterologist, I remember when during our MCH postings, he told me, hey, Surendran, make friends with the junior officers here. And before you could own a unit or head a unit, they all become a top people. They will help you. Literally, that was the one we were following. In fact, people, if they come to know that whatever you do, you don't have any personal benefit in that. Personally, if you are not benefited. So I knew a couple of chief ministers. I knew any number of ministers, any number of IAS officers. Till that day, I have not asked for any personal favor. If at all I go, I'll ask only for the department, I'll ask only for my colleagues, and I'll ask only for the patients, some instrument, this and that, I'll never ask for. So that they really value. You know, I remember, I don't know whether you know Mohan Kameshwaran, the ENT surgeon, you know, the Mark. He rang up one day. He said, Dr. Surendran, are you free? I said, I am free, you know, Mohan. He said, you know, I happened to talk to Chief Minister today, Sunday. And fortunately and surprisingly, he didn't have any visitors. So I was talking to him for 1 hour. And he said, half an hour, we were talking only about you. I said, I hope I've not done any mistake. He said, no, he was praising. I believe you refused Padmashri. So don't do that. I've told him, look, once I get a Padmashri, I will not get anything from my department. I will lose whatever, you know, the kind of an opinion they have on me. That exactly happened. You know, when I went to complain about the slow progression of stem cell, and the chief minister asked me, at that time, the university vice chancellor post was vacant. I remember in 2010, I suppose, yes, that was vacant. He asked me to take up the post. I said, no, sir, I'm not suitable. I have some more work in Stanley. He asked me, you don't want Padmashri? A lot of people, they come and ask me. I said, no, sir, you come and help us for the department. It will be like giving me a Bharat Ratna. Then he said, all doctors, you learn to talk well. And because of that, probably he has given this eight acres of land to Stanley. That's what I used to say. Similarly, when Anmoni Ramadas was a health minister, and in fact, he rang up and asked me to submit application for a B.C. Roy award. I've told him, no, sir, B.C. Roy award doesn't have that much value here. All B.C. Roy Award good teachers, to my knowledge, they are not at all teachers. And all good teachers, they didn't get any B.C. Roy Award. So how can I apply for it? Then he asked me, then what do you want? I told him about the stem cell project. So this we had been going and, you know, almost about 20 times I had visited ICMR, but I didn't get anything. Then he asked me to come and he helped really getting nearly about 14.95 crores to the department for the stem cell lab. So I used to tell in the department, this everybody knows in the department. I used to tell my B.C. Roy award is 15 crores and my Padmashri is 8 acres of land right in front of Stanley. So this all my colleagues, they know. And unfortunately, the DME dean, they do not know about all these things. They didn't know how they got this land allotted. So they started building hostels, some nursing school and all those things. And but the surgical gastroenterology department is still there. But they are doing good work.
No. Yeah, Radha, Swedhan is being modest. I think you have to realize that beyond all this, he's an excellent surgeon. He has got good hands, good decision making. He's an outstandingly good surgeon. As a matter of fact, my grandmother had C.A. rectum in 95 or 96. And she needed an abdominoperitoneal resection. And I asked Surendran to come to Meenakshi Mission Hospital and operate on her. I mean, I didn't want to operate on my own grandmother, so I asked him to come. So I have that much respect for his surgical skill and technique. So the reason why so all these people want to see him, apart from everything else, is because he's an accomplished surgeon. I think we should not forget that in our thing, that it is not his speaking or his dedication to Stanley, that fact that he is an accomplished surgeon. I think that makes a lot of difference, and people like to go to somebody who has been deemed capable by other people.
Sir, if I can ask you, Dr. Ramesh, you are such a passionate academician. There's never a weekend where you don't travel to give lectures when there's no corona. Where do you get this energy? And you know, this every meeting you are there, and whenever I inquire about, then they said, no, he's gone here for, and I think your meetings is booked for years.
Radhakrishnan, as I told you, I was always inclined to be a professor and work in a medical college and teach students. That was my inclination. But as I said, because of the financial and other issues, I decided not to join these places, but to work in the private sector. And so the only way out, if I wanted to have this pleasure of teaching people, was to go for these meetings and give talks and enthuse people with whatever I knew, so that they could do. And I tell you that one of the greatest pleasures I get is when I go for a meeting to someplace in Assam or someplace in Punjab, in Jalandhar or in Ludhiana, and when 3-4 people whom I have never met in my life, they come, and during lunch or something, they talk to me and then they say, sir, we like your lecture, we have learnt a lot and we have utilized it a lot, we thank you and all that. You feel good, you have achieved something. So I couldn't teach in a medical college, so I use this as a proxy for teaching in a medical college. So for that, I have to travel. If I don't travel, then I can't do this. So I don't travel every weekend. I used to keep it at 2 to 3 maximum weekends in a year, in a month, and keep 1 weekend back in Madurai for myself. And and also because I have multivarious interests, I'm interested in open surgery, especially pancreatic surgery and colonic surgery. I'm interested in laparoscopy, advanced laparoscopy. I have interest in endoscopy. So because of that, I attend meetings across the board, you know, endoscopy, laparoscopy, open surgery, IHPBA, IASG. So it becomes a number of organizations, so the number of meetings automatically becomes more.
I've seen you working from early morning till midnight, all your life.
That's true, yeah.
How did your folks take it? You're doing so much for the society, for the specialty, for building, but what have you done for your family?
I think, you know, they have grown with themselves. I'm very happy. You know, my daughter, she's a doctor, and now she's a consultant in King's College London. She's an endocrinologist. My son-in-law is an orthopedics. He is a consultant in upper limb orthopedics in King's College. My younger daughter, I have 2 daughters. My younger daughter is settled well in San Francisco, in spite of me not spending much time with them. Maybe my wife, you know, the credit should go to my wife. She was looking after the entire thing, bearing all the burden. But I'm sure it is for the larger interest. She understood very well, larger interest. So I think I must be really thankful to my wife for all those things, whatever I have done. And even now, she is in the US only. I'm alone at home.
Really?
So, as, yeah, I said, lockdown. So as soon as you asked, I said, yes, at least it's an opportunity to talk to everybody, because hardly you get to have this kind of a thing. And recently, rather, I happened to read a small snippet. It's very interesting. I thought the youngster should know. One CEO of a company, he has written that he had learned his life lessons from his driver. And I was really surprised, how can he learn his life lessons from a driver? His driver said, the day he got his driving license, he thought he's an ace driver. He thought he can drive any car, whether it is a BMW or Audi or whatever it is. Later he realized the life experience is much, much more different than a classroom experience. He got to drive only a Tempo initially. So he didn't get a BMW. And he hit the Tempo, he met with an accident, this and he was chased out. Then for 3 years, he didn't get any job. So he worked as a cleaner in one of the automobile workshops. So there he learned what is under the bonnet, how the engine works, how the radiator works and all those things. And then he got a job from a small-time factory where the management is good, but the salary was very low. But still, the management allowed him to do a lot of work, learn and all those things. This, I thought, we should interpret, you know, to our medical colleagues. You get MBBS, you get MS, you get MCS, you think the next day you can do a liver transplant or you can do a Whipple. That is wrong. When you do that, you will meet with an accident like this driver meets an accident with a Tempo. And it is always better to work in a smaller place. And a good person has to be there, your good mentor, irrespective of the salary, what you're going to get. This mentorship, initially, that's very, very important to probably chisel down your future. So initially, and if you think that he is giving about 10,000 more and 5,000 less and all those things, and your life is going to be doomed. I think every young doctor should know this. The license giving is not, it does not say that he can do anything. No, it only allows you to get trained in a life's experience. That's it. So I liked it. And another one is the Wipro, Ajit Premji. He said, nobody, no cricketer can hit century at every test cricket. If you hit a century, it is happy. Yeah, good moment. You can cherish it. But you don't hit a century, you come out with a duck. Don't get disappointed. Because you should analyze why did you get the duck and try to correct it. It's a life lesson which is better than hitting a century. This one I liked. Another one he said in the, finally in his lecture is, whenever you are confronted with something, don't react. You try to respond. The reaction is the one which your opponent wants you to do it. He wants you to get irritated. He wants you to shout. He wants you to lose your temper. But you are doing that. The response is the one you think over and answer him politely, where he'll be put to shame. These things I cannot forget. And for in a quite a few occasions, I have made use of this also. I thought for youngsters, this would be very, very, very useful. So I thought, what do you say, Ramesh?
Yeah, Pata, I also would like to tell a story which I think is very good. So the story starts somewhere in the 1920 in the state of Alabama in the USA. You know, Alabama is a black predominant state. It is in the south of the United States. It is one of the poorest states in the United States. And there were these two brothers. And they used to go to school. They didn't have money to pay the fees. So the school said that because of that, what you have to do is that every morning you have to come and light the fire of the heater because it was very cold there, so that the whole school will be warm. And so every morning the two brothers will go and light the heater. Now normally they used to use a particular oil for burning the wood. By mistake, the person who was posted that day to buy, instead of buying that oil, he had actually purchased petrol, gasoline, by mistake, and kept it in a tin. So the boys didn't know, they poured it on the wood and they lit it. And you know, gasoline, petrol is highly inflammable. The whole thing caught fire and both the boys got fire. And of the two brothers, the elder brother died from the burns within a very short time. The younger brother was admitted in hospital. And when he was admitted, he has written in his autobiography that he could hear the nurses talking to his mother and the doctors telling his mother that the boy is unlikely to survive. He is burnt so badly. But he survived with the good care. And then he heard them talk that his legs were so badly burned that all the muscles were burnt and there were only bones. There were no muscles literally. So the advice given by the doctors was that he should be amputated because otherwise he won't be able to use those legs. It's a useless limb. But he didn't want amputation, so he told his mother crying, I don't want amputation, I want to go home, let me take home. So finally, the mother convinced the doctor not to amputate, and then she took him home. And every day he has written an autobiography that his mother will put oil on his limbs and his body, and then put him in his wheelchair out in the sun so that his bones would get vitamin D and he can get some strength. But it was assumed that he will have a lifetime in a wheelchair. But he decided that he will try to walk. So, you know, in American houses, they have what is called as a picket fence. You have wooden pieces at regular intervals, and these form the fences. So he wheeled the wheelchair over with great difficulty to the picket fence, caught hold of that wood, and somehow managed to stand up. And he used to stand up for some days. Then next few days, he started walking from one wooden stick to the next, holding on, using his upper limbs to help him walk. And he started walking along the fence every day till he had written his autobiography that you could see in the house that around the picket fence, there was a path worn by my walking. Now that he was able to walk somewhat without support, he started going to school again. And he had to walk to school. There was no bus. But the walk was so painful that this young boy used to run to school every day because he has written that, you know, by running, he could shorten the time of the pain that he faced while moving. And that was shorter and more tolerable than walking. And because he was so interested, he kept on running. And in 1932 Olympic Games in London or Los Angeles or one of those places, Glenn Cunningham, that is his name, won the silver in the 1500 meters running race. And in that career, he set four or five world records for the 1500, for the mile and every race. And in 2000, the American Athletic Federation called him the greatest middle distance runner of the United States of the 20th century. So, when you look at the fact that this was a boy who was handicapped and predicted not to survive, not to walk, but to become the greatest middle distance runner of the country for in a great sporting nation in 100 years, I think that's a story that should encourage us all. That sometimes the day looks very gloomy, it looks very dark. The chief has been shouting, others are getting chances, you are not getting chances, and you are feeling down, depressed. But these are all small things. People have fought much worse things and they have come up. They have fought the prejudice, they have fought color prejudice, and they have come up. So they have spent lives in prison like Nelson Mandela and then come up. And so I think that what we face compared to that is often certainly not in that caliber. And I think that we should not get dejected. And certainly we should try to read these stories and get inspiration and do better in life.
That's true. Ramesh, if you think there is a one quality every doctor should have, what do you think is the one quality?
I think without hesitation, the one quality that every doctor, whether he is a surgical gastroenterologist, liver transplant surgeon, whether he's a cardiologist, whether he's a psychiatrist, is empathy. Exactly. I think
this is what we should keep telling, empathy, 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 and it is completely gone now. That's the reason why probably the doctor's community is losing its name, because we slowly... The empathy is wearing out from our society, the medical society. So, Radha, do you agree with us?
Yes, sir. I agree with this. That's what we're seeing and that's what we're feeling. And that's one of the reasons why you seniors should come and talk about these things and showcase what you have done to reach where you are. And if I can ask you, sir. Yes, sir. Dr. Ramesh.
I think we should point to you as an example of what you should do in life. You are also a very good example to youngsters. You did an MCH from Madras Medical College, and most people would have decided that I have got my MCH, I shall practice, I shall now go and put my board out, I will join and become a consultant and everything. But you decided that you wanted some more experience before you did. So, despite having an MCH, you went and joined as a senior registrar in GI surgery in All India Institute and spent 3 years working with a degree, which the others who were working were still trying to get the degree. They were training for the degree. You already had a degree, but you worked under them, listened to them. I think this is the sort of attitude that you have to have, to learn as much as I can, as young as I can, and a year or two doesn't matter if I have to spend to learn these things. And I think that you are also a walking example of what students should see and try to emulate.
That's true, Ramesh, but more than learning, I think Radha is giving back. You know, he is interested in teaching, arranging for all these classes, the LGS and other things is amazing. How many people they are doing it? You know, dissipating.
No, but that, why did he develop that? Because he felt that during his MS and MCH, people gave him degrees without giving him sufficient training. So he wanted to bring that back. And I think that is something that, unfortunately, in India, we don't have a method of grading these things. That are our students being given enough? And of course, by recently, I am a little disappointed with the government's attitude, where they just out of the blue raise seats to enormous proportions, and they don't see whether the infrastructure can sustain so many students. The Tata Memorial Hospital used to produce the best surgical oncologists in the country. They used to take two people a year, and these people are well trained. They were given, they were made to work hard, but they were trained well. The ones who passed in the initial few years were well trained, excellent surgeons, lot of good hands work they got, everything. But you now know, they take 16
you know,
PGs a year.
So long as I was in Stanley, I was asked to increase the number of seats. I resisted till I was there. There are only 2 MCH per year. But somehow they pushed it. Now there are 7 MCH seats per year.
That exactly.
One MCH people will be there in the department. And I told the minister, look, we don't have infrastructure to train 21. And without training, you give a DVD, it is something like giving a dagger in the hand and saying to go and kill. It is something like that. Without training, you give a degree, a license to practice and then go. It's a rather. And they said, no, Dr. Surendran did not want to increase the number of seats because he did not want to have
competition. We are all told, what I am also told, but I, in the national board, I have 2 seats in a year, and the national board has offered to increase it to 5 seats a year, and I have resisted. I have said, no, I don't want. All my other department colleagues who are getting increased, they come and ask me, we will increase. I said, your students who are there now are coming and complaining to me that they are not getting any training, and you want to increase it to 15 a year, what will you train them? Even the ones you are having now, you can't train. And I don't want that my training should suffer. These people should get a good training. That's why I'm keeping it limited. But the MCH doesn't give you that luxury. They force it on you. They say, no, you have to take so many students. And then, you know, you can't teach. Now, Tata Memorial is stuck with 16 MCH surgical oncology PGs a year, which means that in 3 years, at any time, now they have 48 students. And they simply don't have the work to teach 48.
Vidya, you want to come in?
I'm just enjoying it. I was unlucky not to know either of you very well, but I'm
Vidya, an chief of anesthesia at Malar Hospital. My classmate.
And I have anesthetized a couple of patients, a few patients for Dr. Surendran. He may not remember me. But I'm just enjoying your bonhomie and your camaraderie. And it's so unusual to see two surgeons getting along so fine. And of course, you are scaringly candid. Most people will never say the truth when it's in a public forum. But I'm just dumbstruck. Patta knows that I'm a person who endlessly talks. But I'm just struck dumb by the two of you. Thank you so much.
The reason might be, madam, because we are both cross the age of 60. So we are at the winter of our career, as if you look at the seasons, as you can say. So we are telling this not to criticize people who are before us, but to tell how we should be. And I keep telling my junior colleagues how to treat postgraduates, how to treat interns. Don't treat them harshly. And if you want to scold them, don't do it in public. This is something that's very important, which I think some of us have realized, but many people have not realized. That is that, you know, a person who is doing a DNB in GI surgery, he is a highly qualified professional. He has already done an MBBS, he has done an DMS, he has come through an entrance exam. And if he makes a mistake, more often than not, it is not due to carelessness, it is a genuine mistake. If you have to scold him, the best way is to take him alone into your room, close the door, tell him what you feel, and then don't talk about it outside. I think this is something that distinguishes the able leader from the others. I think that Surendran and I, we all practice this. And both of us, I have noticed over the years, I have seen cases which he has seen in Madras, I have seen. We rarely talk badly of other surgeons. We don't make comments, even if they have made obvious mistakes, we don't tell the patient, because we know that they won't have done it knowingly. They have done it because they didn't know. And the aim is not to put them down in front of the patients or the surgeons. A small incident which I can tell you, that maybe about 10 or 12 years ago, I saw a patient in Madurai who required a cholecystectomy. Unfortunately, his sons were living in Chennai, so they took him to Chennai. Now, if they told me they are going to take him to Chennai, I would have referred them to appropriate people. I would have sent them to Surendran, or I would have sent them to my person who worked with me, Satish, for a long time, who is a very good surgeon, good practice, very good hand. I would have guided them to the right hospitals. But they didn't ask me, they just went away, and I never saw them for some time. I saw them about 6 months later, and they came. And they came to me, they had a drain in the costal margin, they had a subcostal incision, and there was bile was coming. And the imaging showed the gallbladder intact, full of stones, and the bile was probably leaking from somewhere in the gallbladder. The story was that he had been taken for lap coli, they had operated for about 4 or 5 hours, they had failed to do the cholecystectomy, then they converted, they operated for another 3 hours. They got in another one or two surgeons. End of it, they closed up without doing the cholecystectomy, saying it is impossible to do the cholecystectomy. And they told the patient that don't let anybody operate on you. If you operate, you will die on the table. You will have all sorts of problems. The patient came back to Madurai, but he was suffering from a drain and something discharged. So he came to see me. Long ago, I have taken a vow to myself that if I see a patient, I don't care if he doesn't get operated by me. In the beginning, from 90 to somewhere around 98, 2000, if the patient missed me and went somewhere else and then came back to me, I would shout at the patient, I would make sarcastic remarks, why you did not come, why didn't you go back to the doctor? But then I realized that, why am I getting hot? Why am I raising my blood pressure? I don't care if I don't operate this patient. It doesn't matter. I can have other patients to operate, so it doesn't matter. So and that is one of the most important decisions I made in my life, that when I see a patient, if he comes back to me for treatment, I will do it well to the of my ability, best of my ability. Doesn't come back, I don't care. I'm not going to blame him for not coming. So this man was coming and he said that, I'm sorry, sir. I said, don't be sorry. Just tell me what is the problem. We'll see whether we can sort it out. So I didn't want to talk about what had happened, and that pleased him. And we talked about it, and then I said, let me try. You need a surgery, because unless that gallbladder comes, this leak is not going to stop, from what I can see from the investigation. So we should get it out. It looks feasible. Let us do it. So I did start with a laparoscopic cholecystectomy. I said, I will try. And frankly, it was a fairly straightforward lap chole. I finished in about 25 minutes. I removed the gallbladder. The cystic duct was clipped. There was no injury, nothing wrong. It was otherwise all right. And we removed the specimen and patient became all right. But what I'm trying to say is that it's very easy for us to have sat at that table even after the surgery, before discharge, call the relatives and boasted to them. What, you went to Madras, you saw some surgeons, you got operated there. See, we did in 25 minutes what in 6 hours they couldn't do. I could have boasted, put that team down, put those names down. But I didn't. By that time, I'd become mature enough to understand that these things can happen with any of us. All of us can have a bad day in theater. It is not that all of us have all days outstanding. Sometimes you start with a small case, there's hectic bleeding, and finally there's a DIC and the patient is lost. So it happens to every one of us. And there is no surgeon who has no mortality. The difference between a good surgeon and a bad surgeon is a mortality difference of 2%. It will be 95 and 93. That's all that is the difference. It is not like that every patient operated by a poor surgeon will die and every patient operated by a good surgeon will survive. No, it doesn't happen so. That is not the fact of life. So I think that we should remember this and be charitable to our colleagues. And I find that that is becoming less and less in this competitive world. We are eager to criticize our colleagues, eager to put them down. And I think that that is not a good sign. That is not something that should be done.
This is, I suppose, every other surgeon would have such experience, Ramesh. Sometime back, I had a real good life lesson. You know, a doctor from outside, I don't want to name, and far away, he was brought to me by a pathologist. And that gentleman had a cardiovascular junction growth. Then I told him, madam, you probably send him for a neoadjuvant therapy. Let's see how the response is. Then we can plan for a surgery. He's a great surgeon, owning a big nursing home. I think two nursing homes he is owning. Very rich person. He was treating all VIPs, politicians and all those things. Then he came and said to Dr. Surendran, why are you like that? I expected to wear a suit. But he came in a suit, all right. I said, suit is not required for a surgeon. Anyway, you go to the theater, you have to change your dress. He said, he had a kind of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Then he came back after the chemotherapy. Then we did a PET scan that was okay, localized, responded, growth. Then we took him for a surgery. The referred doctor, she also was in the theater. When we did a laparotomy, we saw multiple small nodules in the liver. That was not picked up by the PET scan. So I called her. I said, you are a pathologist. What do we do? There is no point in doing a major surgery when a patient has got a multiple. We all thought it's a secondary liver. So we took a biopsy, sent it for a frozen. It came as a metastasis. Then we had to close the abdomen. We have closed the abdomen and we took a small chunk of liver again for a biopsy. I gave it to her. Please make some good slides. If you have somebody in abroad, send there for a second opinion. Second day, midnight, around 2 o'clock, she rang up. She said, Dr. Surendran, I'm sorry to disturb you. It's 2 o'clock, but it is 2 o'clock in the afternoon in US. She has sent it to Sloan Kettering. They also had problem in diagnosing. They said it is a biliary hematoma. It's not a metastasis. Then I convinced her, okay, we will go on, convince the patient that he needs another surgery. But he's a surgeon himself. In the next post-operative day one, he saw no drains, nothing. He asked the duty doctor, ICU doctor, the surgery over? I said, no, doctor has done, the chief has done a good surgery, it is over. But why didn't he keep a drain? He asked. He said, Dr. Surendran, he doesn't have a habit of keeping drain. He didn't believe, because it's an esophageal surgery. How can they not keep a drain? So he asked the sister to get the case sheet. The case sheet was brought to him. He read. Then naturally, we have to write the truth in the case sheet. So we read inoperable. We have closed the abdomen. That's it. This man broke. And the next day, when we went and said, doctor, we want to tell you something. He said, no, sir, you don't have to tell me anything. I know everything. I know I'm going to live only for 3 months. So I settled my account, I've written my will, I told my wife, he was owning a nursing home, all the ownership I have transferred, and he was living a very big life. I mean, all that I know that I'm going to live only for 3 months. So I said to him, no, sir, the biopsy report, it is confirmed that it is a biliary hematoma. He didn't believe. He said, please don't try to convince me, I'm okay. Then it took really, half an hour for us to discuss with him, took him back for a surgery. And then he became all right. And you see, I saw him 3 years later with a negative PET scan. And you should see that man. He was not wearing when he came for a review, he was not wearing a suit. He was in kurta, paijama kurta. He was such a simple man. He gave me a Mahatma Gandhi, a photograph. He said, one of my hospital, I'm making it into a charity hospital. Now I know what is life. So he said, money is not only thing in life. Life is so insubstantial. I just cannot forget, Radha. This has happened. This has happened recently. And all my colleagues were really surprised. You know, the gentleman came and he talked like that. Before he was talking very, saying, no, you should do this, do that. I'm happy the politicians are standing in a queue right in front of my consultation. All that is gone. So I suppose everybody must realize we also are going to get some problem. We are not going to live eternally. And some surgeon is going to operate on us. And just imagine how it is going to be when we go to a bad surgeon, but a kind of a money-oriented surgeon. So this, I suppose, everybody must remember that we also can be. And in fact, one of a very, very senior, probably the first surgical oncologist in Tamil Nadu, we did recently Vipul on him. And he rang up and told me just day before, I have written a essay, Dr. Surendran. The name of the essay is called A Surgeon and a Knife. I'll send it to you. And I'm just eagerly waiting for his essay on Surgeon and a Knife. How an oncologist felt before undergoing a Vipul surgery. You know, these are all, I suppose, the life lesson. Every youngster should know and they should think that the money, yes, it is important for a comfortable life, but there is no limit to a comfort. You know, having one car is okay, two cars is okay, three cars is okay, but, you know, you can. I remember there is one lady in, I forgot her name, in a CMC, Bellu. She is the head of the Department of Palliative Medicine, the hospice. Everybody must listen to her lecture. You know, in one of the lectures, she said, doctors, we make one extra room to our house. We make 10 patients sell their house. You know, I just cannot forget that word. Everywhere, wherever I go, I used to tell them, please call her and ask her to give a lecture for youngsters. That is for us to listen to. It will be so fascinating, that lecture is. I hope you understand. You agree with me.
Dr. Mohammed Gauss wants to ask a question, sir. Is that okay?
Yeah, please go ahead. Ask him to go ahead. Please.
Yeah, I am Dr. Mohammed Gauss. I am Akbar of Surendran, where I was a classmate as well as roommate of Surendran. And I just want to ask both of you, it was a great conversation and set an example for the doctors to lead the life, professional life, with ethics and values. Really, your best compliments from me for both of you. I just want to ask one question. Having led such practice, such life, have you ever regretted why we were not like other doctors with commercial mind? I just want to answer for this question from both of you.
You know, I mean, from my side, I never regretted, because I thought I'm happy. The way you see, yesterday was a teacher's day. See, okay, the number of compliments and wishes I got is, I keep on deleting the message. And in fact, some of my senior colleagues have sent a card with my photograph and all. I think this, nobody can get with money. Nobody can purchase with money. So I never regretted. Yeah. I'm sure Ramesh also would not have regretted. Ramesh?
No. I never regretted, because, as I said, I felt good to build a department to teach. And like Surajan said, on Teachers Day, when you get from your postgraduates who are practicing and they phone up and then they say that, sir, what we learned from you, we are practicing and we are very happy that it has served us so well. You feel that you have done more than just treat a few patients. You have trained a new generation and they will treat n number of patients which we could not have treated by ourselves alone. So they will go ahead and do a good job. And every time they get some praise, some good name, that will accumulate to us also, even if nobody names it. So I believe that that is... So I have no regrets in life. I have satisfied my professional ego to some extent, my ego as a surgeon to some extent, So I think I'm happy. I would not have imagined that working in a private hospital in Madurai, in a smaller city, I would become president of the Indian Association of Surgical Gastroenterology, president of the Association of Minimal Access Surgeons of India, that I would give the Pandalai Oration to the Association of Surgeons of India. So these are things which I never thought would be possible, and that I have achieved that. I think I feel that to some extent it equates the money that I would have missed by being in a pure practice or building a nursing home. But then I'm also happy, you know, you have a nursing home, you have tough times when your nursing home doesn't do well, you don't have money to pay your nurses. And in this COVID, I know that many of my colleagues are struggling to run their nursing homes. They don't have nurses. Nurses are demanding more salary. And they are all struggling. So I think that that way I feel fortunate that I don't have to answer directly to a nurse or to a staff member.
I understand.
Yeah, thanks for your answer.
You know, the only thing I regret is I couldn't fulfill my dream of starting an institute like an ILVS.
Yeah, that's what the next my question was. Have you done, I mean, everybody would have an ambition or target in their life. When we actually, all of us, when you want to join as a doctor, we have our own set of ambitions, goals and all that. So my next question is, have you totally satisfied with the targets, what you have achieved, or you want to, I mean, there is any lacuna in your achievements?
See, as a student, yes, whatever our ambitions I have achieved. But after being an head of the department of Stanley, I thought I should start a kind of an ILBS in South India, bigger than that. But I didn't get to the 450 crores and I didn't get to start even a big center. So that is my regret. Unfortunately, it is beyond me. So I couldn't.
The next problem is the system is like that, that you cannot train your juniors, I mean, your colleagues to take up the assignments, what you develop. That is one of the other problems you face, right?
No. I think they are doing a reasonably good job. Only thing is the support from higher officials, bureaucrats, and the political support is not that much. It's not there. What I enjoy. Sure.
Even in a private institution like mine, I have given my junior colleagues, their areas, and I left it to them. So Dr. Mohan, who works with me now for 20 years, I've given him the right to do all the liver operations. So even if they come to me now, I refer them to him because, you know, we get less liver. So somebody has to become proficient at liver. They have to do more cases. So unless everybody pulls in, you don't get that many cases. So I've given him the livers. And another person has given them bariatric surgery. So I have divided the work across our own, even in private practice, to whatever they are interested in. And they have taken it up happily because, you know, nothing motivates them like getting something that they are responsible for. I think that's one of the best ways to motivate people. More than money, give them a responsibility and tell them that this is your responsibility. They get happy to do that. I think it's a very important thing.
I open it for questions from anybody. Anybody else wants to? Because, you know, we have taken a good 2 hours of our guest's time. If anyone wants to comment or ask questions. Anjali, you want to say something?
Sir, just to say, sir, it was a wonderful experience, sir. And before giving my sincere thanks to both the stalwarts, my big thank you to you, sir. Because of you, we could listen to the real life experience and which could be carried forward for years together. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thanks. Anyone else want to comment? Bagdi, sir. So,
Sir, I am not a doctor.
Yes.
I am a patient.
Okay.
My name is S.V. Venugopalan. I am an ardent fan of Dr. Surendran. I am amazed and stunned by the standards he has set in his ethical practice and the kind of command he has professed, that much of knowledge and wisdom in his own way. And the kind of warmth he offers to the patients I cannot describe in words. And I am here because I am able to see the love and friendship that has blossomed to this level over the years. My hearty salutes to both of them and my hearty thanks to the organizers.
Thank you. Thank you for this wonderful voice. If you have your camera on, that Surendran may be able to recognize you. Yeah, there are two more.
We all thank Dr. Patta. Thank you for having organized this.
Dr. Palaniappan and this, another guest on iPhone, please come up with your questions.
No, I don't have a question. Surendra, I'm delighted. Really impressed with your aims and what you've achieved. And I think there's something wonderful that you've done.
Thank you.
I'm glad I share some of your thoughts and of your actions in teaching.
Thank you.
It was very good to listen to you. Thank you. Dr. Ramesh, I hope if I come to Madurai, I'll meet you again. Thank you.
Wonderful. Any other comments before we close the session? Sir, it's a great pleasure, and I think this is a wonderful session of two close friends talking about each other. And you know, for us to listen to two legends in the field of GI surgery, they've achieved more than anybody else can achieve. And I don't know, unfortunate that there's nobody who reach anywhere near you or half of you people in the next many years. I think that this will be a great inspiration to a generation of surgeons. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the time.
Thank you, Dr. Ramesh.
Thank you, Sridhar, sir. Thank you, everyone. I shall close the session. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.